गुड इवनिंग डॉक्टर संदीप सर, गुड इवनिंग माथो सर, एंड गुड इवनिंग एवरीवन हु इज लिसनिंग टू पीजीएसएमडी एट दिस आवर। एक्चुअली सर, हेलो, एम आई ऑडिबल सर? हेलो,
To me, you are audible.
ओके,
I'm
थैंक
Dr. Mathur.
यू सर। आई मस्ट कॉन्ग्रेचुलेट डॉक्टर संदीप सर यू फॉर ऑर्गेनाइजिंग दिस नाइन्थ रिफ्रेशर कोर्स सो वेल, एंड आई शुड थैंक यू ऑल्सो फॉर गिविंग मी दिस अपॉर्चुनिटी। Anyway, sir, as said that we will be speaking on the achar of the with the dal, that is anesthesia equipments. As we all of know, there are two kind of table vivas. One is a drug viva, another is the equipment viva. So equipments which I have picked, sir, are the very basic equipments which we are using on the daily basis. So I don't want students to fumble on those daily use equipments. I have picked the very basic questions of those equipments. So either you are given the equipment of your choice, examiner tells you to choose the equipment, or examiner or you choose the equipment, or examiner gives you whatever the thing is. First, you have to identify the equipment. First and foremost, identification of equipment is must. Then you go on with the parts. You mention the specific functions. Then the viva will go on with the uses, indication, contraindications, the method of use, and then the specific points may be asked related to the history or the person invented it. Okay, so first equipment which I have picked up is very common instrument which we are using on the daily basis is the laryngoscope. So first you will identify it as a Macintosh laryngoscope with a curved blade. Then you will further start with the parts and all. Now everybody. Some problem. I think, sir, one slide is missed. Anyway, I will continue with the parts. So laryngoscope is divided into two parts. One is the handle and second is the blade. Now, if we describe the handle part, the handle is divided into the tip, the which we use to elevate the epiglottis. This curved part is called as a tongue or the spatula. And the part which are you seeing the projecting of is known as the flange. And the part which attaches flange to this curved blade is called as a web or a vertical step. The light source is a part of a flange. So this is basically the division of the parts. And there's a base which attaches to the handle. Now laryngoscopes are named on the basis of whether the blades are straight or curved. As this blade is curved and it was discovered by Sir McIntosh, so it was named as a McIntosh blade. The other common blade which we commonly use is a straight blade. It is called as a Miller blade. So it has a long curved tip with a straight blade. The most common use is a pediatric anesthesia. You should be aware of the sizes which we commonly use, like 000 and the 1. And the person who was responsible for discovering this was Sir Robert Arden Miller. Then the question may be, are you aware of any other straight blades? Yes, a Wisconsin blade is there, which is also straight. But in the Wisconsin, the curved tip is not so curved. The distal end is a little wider. Okay, so this is the difference between the Miller and Wisconsin blade. Now, the second part was the blade. Handle. The most important question which will be asked about handle is that what is the connection between the blade and handle? It is called as a hook-on connection. There's a hinge pin on the handle which fits into the slot on the base of the blade. So the most common connection is the hook-on connection. Why this is serrated? Because so that we can grip it firmly. Now, some examiners I have seen, they are fond of asking which battery. So like this handle, we use 2C type batteries of 1.5C voltage. You must have seen the pediatric pen light handles. They use 2 AA size batteries of 1.5 voltage. So these are the questions which can be asked about handle. Now, there are some short and stout handles which are indicated in obese patients with a large breast, or where the cricoid pressure has to be used. They are more useful in those situations. Now, again, as I told you, after parts and after proper indications, you will be asked about the uses. We all know laryngoscope is used for inserting endotracheal tube, placing a device into esophagus, checking the position of tube when we have to remove the foreign body, or for assessment of airway glottic event. Similarly, the complications. We all are aware of the hemodynamic changes, but thing is that you should be well aware of them. You should be able to enumerate your list of complications or uses of that instrument. Now, this is another blade which will be very commonly found on the table. That is the McCoy blade. It's similar to the McIntosh blade. It's a curved blade. But the thing is that it has got an adjustable hinge tip and a lever is present. Now, idea is that you squeeze the liver and you elevate the epiglottis gently. So it is more common, useful in the situation where the larynx is very anterior. And with the help of the squeezing the liver, you can change the grading of cormic length from 3 to 2, or you can at least use that situation of anterior larynx. You can make it less anterior. But the problem is that there could be trauma of epiglottis. Epiglottis can happen if it, this that tip, that epiglottis, it gets caught in the hinge of the movable tip. So it is also very common laryngoscope you will found. Now, another thing which is very common nowadays, and I think in good institutions or in medical colleges, they will be on the table. And these are the video laryngoscopes. In COVID era, we are very commonly using them. So you should know what is the what are the indications of them, that this is part of indirect laryngoscopy. What are the others, video laryngoscopes? At least you should name them. TMAC laryngoscope is there. This is King Vision. Other are AirTrack. Megra is there. The Glidoscope is there. So you should be aware of the video laryngoscope. You should be able to identify them. You should be able to tell them the indications. Now, another very common equipment which are using on the daily basis is the face mask. Now, you should not, you cannot miss this on identifying this. So this is, I have used two pictures. One is with hooks and other is without hooks. Both are available. So face mask, as we know, it allows the gas administration to the patient from the breathing system without introducing any apparatus. Now, thing is that it is made up of anti-static material. Why it is black in color? It is made up of black rubber. But why it is black in color? Because some charcoal is always being incorporated to give that color black. And it is made anti-static material because of that. Reason is we want, don't want the ignition of any anesthetic gases there. So it can be made up of black rubber. The face masks are available in plastic. There is elastomeric material or disposable masks are also available. Now, this is the most common mask, hooked mask, anatomical mask, which we are using. So identification is, it is anatomical rubber, black rubber face mask, also called as Connell mask. So you should be aware of the sizes, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. These are, now next question is, why the hooks are there? I will come to that. Now, now you have identified, the next part is come to the parts of face mask. The first part is the body. The body is the main part of the mask. It could be transparent, it could be opaque, it could be black, it could be or silicone-like transparent. So the main part which you see, you take it in your hand, the main part you see, it is the body. It, now, another question will be like, why the mask, face masks are transparent? That's another question. The second part is seal. Seal is basically the rim, the flap or edge which comes in contact with the face is called as a rim or flap or edge. It is basically responsible for making that seal. Now, it could be two types, the pad or cushion type or flap type. The cushion type is when you inflate it with air or filled with a material that will conform to the face when pressure is applied. Second is the flap type. Like because there's a body is very flexible and that flexible extension conforms to the contour of the face and it pressed into the face to create a seal. Now the third part is a connector. That is opposite to the side of the, that is on the opposite side of the field. It has a thickened fitting with a 22 millimeter internal diameter. So you should know the diameter of this. Second, why the hooks is this, you can see a ring with the hooks. Why this ring with hooks is placed around the connector so that the mask straps can be attached there. Now the what kind of mask straps? Normally they are not seen usually nowadays, but yes, for the table viva, it can be important. So these were the mask straps which were used with these hooks to tighten the mask on the face. Now, problem is that these masks can cause facial injury. These mask straps, if tightened, can cause facial injuries. So the gauze sponges have to be placed between the straps and the skin so that to protect the face from the excessive pressure. Another risk of using these mask straps is that it will take longer time to remove the mask if vomiting or regurgitation occurs. Now, this is very common mask. Everywhere you can identify where it is. It's a Cossack mask. Okay. Some examiner can ask you spelling also. So it's a triangular mask designed for the pediatric patient. The rim, the seal is flat kind of seal. It is usually available in 00, 0, 1 and 2 sizes. It has a very low dead space, 4 ml in size 1 and 8 ml in size 2. Sorry, I forgot to tell about the dead space of anatomical mask. That was around 150 to 250 ml. It very adequately fits into the child face as no special seal is needed. Now, you can see variety of masks around. They could be Ambu transparent masks. They could be silicone transparent masks. Thing is that the parts are same. Another mask, which was very common in our days was this. It was a trimer mask. It's similar to Connell mask, but it has a shallow body and it is very less dead space. Now again, now further, your examiner can ask you about how do you hold it, how you can, what are the one-handed techniques, what are the CE technique, what are the two-hands technique. So examiner is very fond of asking is Eshmark Hebberg maneuver. It's nothing but the Jarthus maneuver. Okay, so Eshmark Hebberg maneuver is a Jarthus maneuver. Don't confuse it with a heavy spelling. Now again, the next is the advantages. Like if a patient who has to be undergone under anesthesia with a mask, then advantages are definitely less sore throat, less depth of anesthesia, resuscitation and ventilation can be done. But disadvantage are you cannot go on for prolonged surgeries in that. MRI, CT scans are not possible. More desaturation episodes, more facial injuries, more pressure injuries, risk of aspiration, and the user fatigue is very common. Plus the environmental risk of environmental pollution is always there. So next, the next important instrument is the oral airway. The Goodall's where I think everybody is very, very much familiar with. So first you have to identify it, that it's a Goodall oropharyngeal airway used to maintain the patency of oral airway for an unobstructed breathing. That is the thing you will see about that. Now come to the parts. The first part is flange, which remains outside the lips, is a flange. It is to limit the depth of insertion. It should not over, it hampers the over insertion of the oropharyngeal airway into the oral cavity. Second is the color coded. The white is color coded because range of sizes are available because of the color. About 9 sizes are available and they are in the 9 different colors. Then there's a reinforced white block. Then the curve. The curve is made like it should conform to the contour of your tongue. You know, it is kink resistant and it keeps the epiglottis off the posterior pharyngeal wall. Then the edges are tapered. So to reduce the oropharyngeal mucosal trauma or on insertion, it is made up of latex-free, biologically inert polymer. These were the different sizes I was talking about. 000 is used for the preterm neonates and 6 is basically used for the morbid obese patients. Parts I have discussed. Now, again, very, very important is they will ask you about the method of insertion. Because in children, you don't reverse it to the 180, you don't change it to the 180 degree. You can use it with the help of tongue depressant, you can directly insert it. Though in the adults, you first go with the concave side and then you turn it into the 180 degree. Again, correct size estimation, very, very important. Why the correct size is important? Why not to use the oversize? Why not to the undersize? Oversize will cause the injury to the laryngeal structures. Oversize will push the epiglottis and further will cause the obstruction of the glottis. So correct size is it. Now, how do you do the correct estimation? I have compared both mesopharynx and oropharyngeal here on the one slide. So for the oropharynx, you put the flange on the angle of the lip and this tip should come onto the angle of mandible. While in the nasopharyngeal airway, the tip should be on the lateral edge of nostril. Tip should be on the tragus of ear, and flange should be on the lateral edge of nostril. So this is the way we estimate the correct size, and we should always put the optimum size airway. Again, what are the uses of oropharyngeal area? As I told you, to maintain the open airway, to prevent the tongue bite, to facilitate suction, conduit for passing devices into pharynx. The point to remember here is that you should not use Goodall's airway in the patients who are very conscious because of the risk of gagging, vomiting, and aspiration. And hence, the more injury of soft tissue trauma to the tongue, palate, and pharynx also occur. So the contraindications are intact gag reflex and oral growth. Now, I would also like to mention here some specific airways which may be present in the museum of any medical, some medical colleges or institutions. One is the Waters airway. The Waters airway is now hardly it's being used, but it was made up of metal with an oval flange and the bite block was straight with an anatomically curved pharyngeal section and holes were present at the side near the distal end. And this the port you can see, you can give oxygen through that. Now the use has been discarded because it can cause damage in soft tissue a lot. Moreover, it's not transparent, so you cannot see any foreign material lodged within it or not. The same metallic airway, another is called as the Connell's airway. The difference between Water and Connell's airway is only this, that the oxygen port is not there. Now the other is the COPA, very common airway, very commonly found, very commonly seen. So you should be well aware of that. It's a modified version of the oral airway with a cuff. So when the cuff is inflated, it provides an airtight seal. It is a more likely seen as like an LMA only. Okay. So, but it requires more manipulation for placement. The next is the Burman intubating airways. These are the new airways, which you should be well aware of. The main special part thing about these airways are that these airways are first used in as an oral airway, as well as they are used as an aid to fiber optic or blind orotracheal intubation. The reason is that they are tubular along its entire length and they're open on one side. So when the fiber op- when the tube is inserted, they can be very easily removed. They can be very easily removed from around, they can be split and removed from around the tracheal tube. So that way the tube is not disturbed. Another is Ovacepian fiber optic intubation, intubating airway. It was also designed to deliver a fiber scope as close to the larynx as possible. At the buccal end, if you can see, there are two vertical side walls, and between them is a pair of guide walls that are curving toward each other. There is a, that is a part through which the tracheal tube passes, you know, like this. And up to 8 or 9 millimeter of endotracheal tube can be easily passed. They are available in 3 sizes. And when the tube is inserted, it is also unlatched and taken out. Another intubating airway now, which is seen in the market, is a William intubating airway. And it is also used for a blind orotracheal intubation. The distal part only is open. The rest is like the normal oral airway. Next is the Patel Syracuse endoscopic airway. It is made from aluminum and it is designed to aid the fiber optic intubation. So this is the special part is that it has lateral channels and a central groove on the lingual surface to allow a fiber scope with the tracheal tube to pass. And there's a slit at the distal end, which allows the fiber scope to be manipulated in the anterior posterior direction. So you have a lot of name of airways, which you can use as aid in fiber optic intubation. Another, when you're talking about oropharyngeal airway, you have to talk about nasopharyngeal airway. The parts are same, tip, curved body in a flange end. Like, okay, the very important question, which is commonly being asked is, when you insert it, how do you insert it? Where should be the bevel facing? Bevel should be facing toward your nasal septum. What are the various sizes available? And the method, how to estimate the correct size that I have already told you. Now, again, the use of nasopharyngeal airway is to maintain the airway in patient. The hair specialty is that you can use it in the patient with an intact gag reflex. Okay. In the conscious patient, then they are far easy. Those patients, this airway is far easier to tolerate than the oral airway. And it can act as a guide for fiber of scope or nasogastric tube. And you can also use it to dilate the nasal passages in preparation for nasotracheal intubation. So you have to remember the list and the uses. One thing is very important is the contraindication, where you don't have to use it. The base of skull or nasal fractures, coagulopathy, nasal pathology, and wherever there is a history of epistaxis, there you will avoid putting nasopharyngeal air. Now, I was, this was this stilet, this is a Dr. Talwarkar stilet, and this was present in my KGMC Institute. So I have seen it, I have put it here only just to show that this is some kind of a stilet. I don't know whether nowadays it is available. It is not right now. It is not available in our institute. It is called as a direct Dr. Talwarkar stilet. The main the good part about the stilet is that you can still change the shape of the curvature of the stilet while you're intubating. So it can be used for the nasal intubation. It can be used for the oral intubation, both through the red rubber and the PVCs. So I find it fascinating. So I put I thought to put it here. Now again, very important thing, which is very favorite instrument of examiners. And I think you cannot miss this on identification because you're using it as a part of BLS, resuscitation teams. So it's a very common instrument to be used every day. Now it is called, the names are self-inflating bag, or it is called as a bag wall mask assembly, or it is called as a manual resuscitator, or the AMBU, which is very commonly name being used. You should know the full form AMBU, that is artificial manual breathing unit. Before going on to the parts, I must tell you the indication first. As we all know, it is used to provide positive pressure ventilation to all those patients who are not breathing adequately. The device is a required part of resuscitation kit in and out of hospital, both settings, and it can be used for the temporary ventilation of patients. Now, what are the various parts of this? Now this bag, this is an assembly. Sometimes the examiner can detach the whole assembly and can provide you the parts and will tell you to assemble it. So you should know how to assemble it. The assembling is a mask is there, the self-inflating bag is there, and a reservoir bag is there. The bag which you are seeing here is made up of inert plastic and it is self-inflatable. You compress it, it will come back. The various sizes available are 240 ml, 500 ml and 1600 ml, the infants, children and adults. The part where the oxygen is connected is away from the patient, opposite to the patient, and here we attach the oxygen and there's an oxygen inlet and there's a attachment for the reservoir bag. Now the oxygen flow rate should be or equal to higher than the minute volume of the patient to allow 100% oxygen to be delivered. Now the where we attach the oxygen reservoir, there are two one-way valves. One is for the air in and one is for the air out. Whenever the pressure of oxygen is less or less flows are being given to the patient, it will entrain air from outside. And whenever there is a pressure out, whenever there is a pressure more, it will exit the excess oxygen from that air outlet valve. And another valve we've seen is the air inlet valve, which does not allow oxygen to come back into the reservoir. At the patient end, there's a non-rebreathing valve, which directs the fresh flow of oxygen to the patient and prevents the exhaled gas re-entering the bag. As usual, a standard 15 mm adapter for attaching to airway devices. The blue valve which is seen is a pop-up valve, and it basically manages the increased pressure in the circuit. It releases at about 60 centimeter water, and the peep valve can be attached, or sometimes they are come built in the ambu bag only. So again, after the part and assembly, after the indications, next thing is the complications. The complication, there's a chance of hyperventilation with these ambu units anytime. If you are not able to manage it with a proper CE grip, there will be poor seal, risk of gastric distension, aspiration, claustrophobia, and the exhale secretions can cause exhalation valve dysfunction and increased resistance to expiration. If proper valve is not proper working, then there's a risk of barotrauma, and anytime there could be equipment failure due to incorrect assembly. So next will be, they can ask you again, how to hold it and how to give the proper ventilation with this. Now, the most very common use, you cannot miss on this, is the endotracheal tube. Endotracheal tube is to use to deliver the oxygen to the lungs. You can should not miss on the parts of this. If you start with the distal end, then the parts which we should know about the endotracheal tube is, you will identify it as a PVC endotracheal tube. Okay, it's made up of, the tube which you are seeing on the screen is made up of PVC. So we'll identify it as a PVC endotracheal tube used to give for giving oxygen, providing oxygen to the lungs. Now, if you start at the distal end is which goes into the trachea. There's a first part is bevel, second is a Murphy, then is the cuff, third next is a black marker which acts as a vocal cord guide. Then you can see a blue line which is a radio marker, radio opaque line. Then is a inflation system, which there is an, you can see an external inflation line with the pilot balloon, and a single one-way valve spring loaded valve is there. And it's transparent with a 15 mm adapter. Now coming to the parts. Now this first is the bevel and the Murphy's eye. First coming to the bevel. Now bevel is, if we take the endotracheal tube in our hands, the bevel will face towards the left side. So why it is made left side? Because for the better visualization of glottis, the bevel is been curved like this, and for the easy insertion through the glottis. Now, what is the angle of bevel? The angle of bevel is around, it's acute. It is around 38 degree plus minus 10. It's very commonly asked. Now, second part is the Murphy eye. What is the advantage of Murphy eye? Whenever there's a distal occlusion because of secretions, or you're this main, the main hole is occluded because of secretions, at least there's some alternate hole, you know, so that to deliver some oxygen to the lungs. J. Murphy was a person who had this idea. So on the name of his, it was named as a Murphy eye. Now, what is the disadvantage of Murphy eye is that, since because of the Murphy eye, cuff has to be placed proximally. Now, if cuff is more distally, it will definitely decrease the chance of inadvertent bronchial intubation. So this you should know about the Murphy eye and bevel. And Murphy eye is absent in which tube is the Majels. The red rubber tube is, which I will come next, is absent in the red rubber tube. Angle of bevel, I have told you. In most of the tube, there it is written Z79 or F79. That refers to that your tube has passed the tissue toxicity test. The next is the cuff. Now you should be aware of what kind of cuffs are available, the high pressure, low volume cuff and high volume, low pressure cuffs. Your red rubber tubes mostly have the low volume, high pressure cuffs. They are more circular in shape, while your high volume, low pressure cuffs are more elliptical in shape. You should know the advantages and disadvantages. At high volume, low pressure cuff will definitely decrease the chances of tracheal ischemia and necrosis, but definitely increase the risk of microaspiration. Similarly, low volume, high pressure cuff will prevent microaspiration, but increase the chances of the tracheal ischemia and necrosis. And you should know the which target pressure you should be able to achieve, you know, that it should be between 20 to 30. You should not never go beyond 30 centimeter. Now there's a black marker, which is basically a vocal cord guide. This black mark should cross the vocal cords. In some tune there are two black markers, then the vocal cords should remain in between these two black lines. Now, very common is being asked question is that when you talk about the size, like 6 size, 7.5, 8, what does it refer to? It refers to the internal diameter. Okay. And why always largest possible size should be selected? To decrease the resistance. The lesser the size, there will be increase in 4 times the resistance. Okay, so always the largest possible size should be chosen. Now, I find it very interesting that we know that this is a catheter mount, but why this is called as a catheter mount? The catheter mount has its own advantages and disadvantages, but why it is called catheter mount? Because when endotracheal tubes were designed initially, they were not called as endotracheal tubes, they were called as endotracheal catheters. Okay, and so anything mounting on endotracheal catheters were called as the catheter mounts, and it attaches to your tube 15 mm diameter. It's a standard universal connector. Now the tubes, another tubes which are very commonly seen on the table is red rubber. Red rubber, why it is called red rubber? Because it is made up of Indian rubber. India rubber that is red in color. These are reusable, these are autoclavable, and there's no murphia in that. The angle of bevel is same, around 30 degree in this. I forget to mention the radius of curvature. The radius of curvature, is the curvature of the tube, you know, and that is also called as the Magill's curve. Why Magill's curve? Because the Magill was a person who designed this tube, and so the curve is named on his behalf. To give him the honor, it is called as a Magill curve, and the Magill curve is around 140 mm plus minus 20. So the radius of curvature is same as that in the PVC tube, and there's a risk of latest allergy. Now again, when you talk about the endotracheal tube, the next most favorite question will be how will you differentiate red rubber tubes? What are the differences between the red rubber tubes and the PVC tubes? Red rubber tubes can be reused multi times, while PVCs are more disposable. They are not transparent. PVCs are transparent. The red rubber tubes have a problem. They become hardened and become sticky with age, and they're very poor resistance to kinking. They become clogged by dried secretions. While PVCs still are less likely to kink than the rubber tube. They can kink, but less likely than the rubber tube. And they are stiff enough for intubation at room temperature. Plus, the risk of latest allergy is always with the red rubber tubes. Now, another very favorite tube to be asked is a flexometallic armored or reinforced tube. So it can be called as a reinforced, it can be called as armor, or it can be flexometallic. Again, what was the use that we need to use this tube? What are the indications in which surges it should be used? It is a spiral viral embedded tube. Now, this tube, because of the spiral embedded wire, it is used in those, it has a less risk of kinking and getting compressed. So all those surgeries where there's a risk of compression and kinking, like headache nerve surgeries, thyroid surgeries, cervical spine surgeries, prone position, this tube should be preferred. Okay. Now, what these are the advantages. Now, what are the disadvantages? Since this tube is very flexible, so it requires stillet and forceps for the insertion. Moreover, there could be permanent deformity if patient bites it. If you shorten the tube, it cannot be cut. So these are again, advantages, disadvantages, you should be aware of. Next is the preformed ET tubes. Why they are called as the preformed ET tubes? Because already the shape is preformed. You cannot deform that or you cannot change the shape. So they are called as the preformed ET tubes. The other names are RA tubes. The RA tubes are the example of preformed ET tubes, ring adhere Elvin tubes, or they are also called as a north-facing or south-facing tube. The tube which is in the upper direction is south-facing, the connector is facing towards your feet is called a south facing. If universal connector facing towards the forehead is fixed on the nasal bridge and forehead, it is called as the north facing tube. North facing is more commonly for the nasal surges. South facing is a nasal intubation. South facing is for the oral airway. Now again, there's a mark at the vent which denotes the position at the teeth or nares. It should lie at the teeth or your nares, you know? And these tubes are easy to secure. And once they are secured, the risk of unattended extubation is less. But the problem is these tubes are difficult to suction and there's a high chance of increased resistance. Now, another very favorite tube is DLT. If you pick up a DLT, you're thorough with this. You tell all the points of the DLT, you are 100%, there's no chance of failure. You know, it's a such a tube. And the tube which you're seeing on the screen is a left-sided Robertshire double level tube. Basically, these are the two tubes which are incorporated into the one another, naming as the double lumen tubes. Okay, one is for the trachea, one is for the endobronchial. So all the parts which you're seeing is a left-sided Robertshire double lumen tube. Another tube are the Carlin's tube. The Carlin's tubes are the double lumen tube. They are the left-sided tube with hook. Another is the right tube, which is the right-sided with hook. The Robertshire is most common. They are available red rubber as well as the disposer. PVCs are also, Robertshires are also available. This is the Carlin's tube, which is seen on the screen. It has a carinal hook, now not hardly used. Now this is a PVC tube with a, this is a double lumen tube with a part. Always remember it is made up of the disposable and made up of PVC. There are two cuffs. One is the bronchial cuff and there is a tracheal cuff. The tracheal cuff is above the tracheal lumen. The bronchial cuff is above the bronchial lumen. And the blue part, blue color is given basically in the tube to denote the endobronchial component. Blue pilot balloon, blue cuff, the blue tube. That means that is a tube which is going endobronchial. Okay. And this port connector, another which you are seeing on the screen is that is connected to the tracheal and bronchial end. And the tube which is connected, which is coming after the port connector and is connected, will be connected to the ventilator, is made up of silicone, very soft. And it is the part where the tube should be clamped. Okay. And we should know how much air we have to infuse into the tracheal cuff and into the bronchial cuff. Another difference is the right side tube has widely shaped eccentric cuff. The idea is to prevent the occlusion of the upper lobe bronchus. The left sided has normal cuff. Okay. Now again, when DLT is there, you will be definitely asked what are the indications, where do they have to be used. You should know all the indications or the lungs, for the lung separation, to isolate the lung, to control the distribution of ventilation, or for the bronchopulmonary lavage. You should be well versed with all these things. Now, so questions can be types of tube, what are the sizes available, uses, indication, contraindication, complications, how do you check for positioning, why left side is preferred. Left bronchus is 50 to 60 millimeter, right is smaller, so there's a more margin of safety. What should be the depth of insertion? Usually with the 177 centimeter, the depth is 29 centimeter is fine, but with 10 centimeter difference in height, the 1 centimeter variation there, those are very vague kind of thing, but it's written in the literature, so I'm mentioning it. Now, what is the problem with these tubes? You should always remember there's a high chance of failure of intubation. There's a high chance that the lung isolation will not be proper. Injury to airway is common. Hypoxemia can be there. And these tubes need expertise to put, and they are contraindicated in difficult airway. So if I summarize it, you should be well versed with the DLT if you're picking it up. From the method of insertion, and checking of how to check whether it is left-sided or right-sided. Another tube, it could be present there is a laser-resistant ET tube, then your viva will move toward why we need this laser-resistant ET tube, what is the risk, and what is the risk of flammability, what are the surges where it should be used, what kind of ET tubes are available like this. So either the standard tubes are like red rubber or PVCs are wrapped in the aluminum or protective metal foil, or some silicon-based laser shields tubes are available. And what other preventive measures you can use, you can do to decrease the flammability in the laser surgeries. So these are the questions which can come with the laser-resistant endobronchial tubes. Right. Another instrument which I picked up is cuff manometer, because you should know how to use it. how it is connected to the pilot pelon. There's a hook which is directly connected to the pilot pelon. You should remember that it measures the airway pressure. It also adjusts the airway pressure. There's a red button on the side, which if you use it, it will deflate the extra pressure. So if next question can be, what is if you find the pressure zero? What is the possibility? So either the either cuff is disrupted, there is some injury to the cuff, or there's occlusion to the tube. So that way the question will arise, but you should be able to identify it. Next, I picked it up because it was in my institute. I have seen this personally. It is also called as an airway prop, also called as a London dental prop. It's a basically circular hollow piece of metal to prevent the biting of ET. It's a kind of a bite block. And tube is inserted in the hollow of the prop. One of my very favorite instruments, so I picked it up. You cannot miss this on identifying it. It's a gum elastic bougie. Though I should tell you that the gum elastic bougie is a misnomer. There's nothing which is made up of, it's not made up of resins or something like which is like gum-like. Or it is neither elastic nor it is used for the dilatation. Usually bougies is a word which is used for dilating something. So it is not a gum elastic. The name is Eshman Tracheal Tube Introducer. Okay. It's a flexible device, 60 centimeter in length, 15 French diameter, with a small hockey stick angle at the distal end. And the angle is 35 to 40 degrees. And some bougies are available with a central lumen and a port for ventilation, and they can be used as the tube exchangers, you know. Now, the different sizes are available, 10 or 15 Frenches there. Then they can ask you what do you hear, what do you listen when you this is inserted into the trachea. The tip, as it touches the tracheal link, there's a click sound, and you should know about the indication in the use of difficult airways during tracheal intubation, you know. During trichothyrotomy, you should be well aware of the indication. So it is called as the ESH introducer. Now, another very simple instrument, you can pick it up, and I picked it up because there were some specific points I should like to mention here. Is it is called as a medial forceps, but the curve which you are able to see is the dynafoam curve. The dynafoam curve was made so that we can insert into the oropharynx. Okay, And there's an angle. The angle between handles is the oblique angle. Why there's an oblique angle? Because to prevent the obscuration of the view of the airway during use, it should not come into the view. If you're using it for packing or if you're using it for passing the endotracheal tube into the larynx, the angles were made like that they should not come into the view. So, and the serrated. So this is the two important parts, the dynafoam curve and the oblique angle. Now, it uses, you all of you are aware of that it helps in the passage of endotracheal tube into larynx. It aids gastric tube passage into the, to remove the foreign bodies from the airway, to place the pharyngeal packs, you know, and the problems are local trauma, cuff damage can there. One arm may lodge in the murphyi. You are unable to grasp the small objects, and it definitely needs practice. Now, another thing is the oxygen delivery device. Because it's the huge bunch of oxygen delivery devices would be lying on the table, and examiner would definitely talk about that, would ask about that. So you should be well aware, since there's a one talk on the oxygen therapy, I know about that. So you should be well aware of what are low flow systems, what are high flow systems. When you identify the oxygen delivery device, you should be able to tell that whether it's a low flow, high flow, fixed performance, variable performance, how much FiO2 we can give, how much flows we have to maintain, and what are the advantages and disadvantages. Low flow systems are nasal cannula. They're dependent on basically patient tidal volume, intranasal catheter, simple mask, partial rebreathing, and non-rebreathing. While your high flows, venturi system, paste and high flow nasal prongs. And the first coming to the nasal props, you should aware of the flow rate, how much flow rate we can give. It's about 1 to 6 liters per minute. The FiO2 we can give is 0.24 to 0.44. That is the nasal prongs. What are the advantages? What are the disadvantages? It's ideal for the patients on long-term oxygen therapy. Patient is very comfortable with the nasal prongs. They're very lightweight. Patient is able to speak. Humidification is not required, and they are definitely very cheap. But the disadvantage, you cannot provide high flow oxygen. It causes dryness of mucosa. It's very irritating, and high flow rates are very uncomfortable. Similarly, next is the simple face mask or the Hertzel mask. Very common instrument. You're using it seeing it on the daily basis. You should be well aware of the this instrument. Again, it's a low flow device with a variable performance. It's a variable with a variable performance system. It's the reservoir capacity of this mask is around 100 to 250 ml. Okay. Different oxygen flow rates would result in high variable and unpredictable FiO2. Okay. So if you are keeping the flow rates less than 2 liter, there is a chance of rebreathing. 4 liter of a minute per oxygen is enough to deliver about 0.35 to 40% of FiO2. If you increase it up to 8 liter, there is no increase in FiO2. So 5 to 8 flow liter flow rate you have to keep, and FiO2 you can deliver is 40 to 60%. Again, merits are, it's good for patient with a blocked nasal passages. It's easy to apply if the patient is comfortable with this. But demerits are, you cannot, proper fitting is required, risk of aspiration in unconscious patient, and chance of rebreathing is also there. Plus, patient cannot eat with this one. Now, this is again, thing you pick it up and the patient and the examiner will be very happy. And if you're thorough with that, again, no chance of failure. So it's a Venturi mask. It's a, again, it's a fixed performance device, high flow device. Okay. You should be well versed with this equipment. Now, it's another name of Venturi mask is air entrainment mask. Why it is called as air entrainment mask, I will tell you. Now, first thing is that it delivers fixed concentration of oxygen. The size of the valve, the size of the constriction determines the final concentration of oxygen for a given gas flow. The next question is, on which principle does it work? It's work on the Venturi principle. The Venturi principle is that if air or gas or a liquid, if it flows from a large orifice to a narrow orifice, the velocity increases, but the pressure decreases. And to compensate for that pressure, it entrains the fluid or gas, whatever it is. Similarly, this as the forward flow of inspired air increases, the lateral pressure to the vector of the flow decreases. It results in entrainment of gas. Smaller the orifices, remember, the greater the negative pressure will be generated, there will be more fall of the pressure, more ambient air will be entrained, and the lower will be the FiO2. So how much FiO2 we can deliver from 24% to 60%. Now, this is the adjustable Venturi valve, which is more commonly you have seen in your wards, and you should be well aware of all the color-coded valves available, and which at what FiO2 they can give, and at what liter per minute. Okay, this should be, you should be, you know, well acquainted with this. And this was the Venturi principle I was talking about. Now, another question is, how is Venturi mask different from others? First thing is, it is used in the patients who require long-term oxygen therapy and who they are dependent on their hypoxia drive. For example, COPD patients. It's a very good for COPD patients. It is different from other, masks because it is more effective at delivering the accurate oxygen concentration. Okay, so a fixed kind of high flow oxygen can be delivered through this mask. This is the basic concept of this mask. Again, very favorite of examiners is the non-rebreathing mask. One is partial rebreathing mask. This is non-rebreathing mask. It's a bag with the oxygen reservoir. The parts are, there's an inspirational unidirectional valve, which allows the oxygen from reservoir back to the patient. And there's a port to deliver the oxygen, through which the oxygen is connected, and two expiration valves. So total three valves are there. Two expiration valves, which are unidirectional, and one is inspirational valve. The expiration valve, when patient expires, the unidirectional inspiration valve is closed, and the patient expires. And when patient is when the oxygen is delivered to the patient end, the expiration valves are closed. There is no entrainment of air from the outside. So it's kind of provide 100% of oxygen to the patient like this. These are the expired one-way valves. These are the inspired one-way valve. And there is no mixing of inspiratory and expiratory gases. This is the same that one-way valves in the mask prevents the entrainment of room air. The expired air escape through side vents and around the sides of the mask. Now they're capable of giving 90 to 100% FiO2 at 10 liter flow rate. Now, indications, very important. All the patients who require high FiO2, more than 40%, this can be used, but the contraindication patient should not have poor respiratory efforts or apnea. They become the more for the mechanical ventilation. Now, advantages are you can give highest possible FiO2. They are suitable for spontaneously breathing patients. receiver hypoxia. Disadvantage is it interferes with eating and drinking. It requires tight seal and it becomes uncomfortable for the patient. So not very suitable for the long-term use. And the, and malfunction can cause CO2 buildup in suffocation. Now this is a partial rebreathing mask. Now how does it differentiate from the, like you, if you can see, if you can make out the, there are expiration walls, there are no expiration, there are no flaps on the expiration wall. This is the difference. And because of this, the patient, when the patient inspires, it oxygen delivers to the patient end, but when patient expires and it entrains also, it goes outside, air is also entrained, plus there's a mixing of the inspired and expired gases. So it leads to partial rebreathing, but still is a very useful mask, though not much in the clinical practice, but it can be lying there on the table and you should know what is the basic difference between the partial rebreathing and the non-rebreather mask. It can deliver an FiO2 up to 0.8. A minimum of 8 liters per minute should enter the mask to remove the exhaled CO2 and to refill the oxygen reservoir and to prevent rebreathing. And the flow rate should be sufficient to keep back 1/3 of half inflated at all times. Now again, maybe this could be lying on the side of the table and you're very commonly seeing it nowadays and everybody's talking about this. So I just picked up this slide and put it here. It's a high flow nasal cannula. You should know its indication, how much oxygen can be given, what FiO2 and all, you should be aware of that. This is a table in which I've summarized all the like what are variable devices, which devices are fixed, which are variable, how much a liter of oxygen should be given to maintain how much FiO2. Now, a reason to pick up the spinal needle is that I think everyday anesthetist is using spinal needle or epidural, but I have seen students fumbling even the length of spinal needles is asked. So I thought to just pick up one or two slides on the spinal needle and the epidural needle. You should be well aware of its length, whether the needle you are picked up is dura cutting or dura separating. The dura cutting or the quinque needle, which we are commonly using, dura separating is a Whitaker and Scotte. You should be aware of the sizes, what colors are available, for the at least for the most common you are using. The most common standard spinal needle which we are using is the quinque needle. The length is 3.5 to 4 inches or 90 millimeter. Okay, the different lumen sizes are there. Why there is a stilet? I have seen one examiner asking why there is a fitted stilet which can be detachable. Very simple answer is so that you the epithelial cells coming into the way should not be tracked into the subarachnoid space. That is the reason. So there is a fitted stilet which can be detachable. So, and if once you are able to tell about the spinal needle parts and color coding, positioning, structure peers, drugs, adjuvants, what are the factors which are responsible for the height of block, complication, management period, the viva can go in any direction, you know. Again, about the TOIS needle. Length of TOIS needle is 80 millimeter, 8 centimeter. The markings are at the 1 centimeter part. I have seen 110 centimeter also. The most common epidural TOIS needle which we use are of 16, 17, 18, 19 gauge. 19 is of pediatric. It is of 5 centimeter. The epidural filter size is 0.2 micron. The catheter length is 100 centimeter. The Huber tip is the needle tip, the blunt tip which we see. The idea is to not to injure the dura. So it has, the bevel is made the blunt. What is the angle of, at the curve tip is 15 to 30 degrees. These are very simple questions you should know. And examiners, if you pick up, they will ask these questions. Okay, in CSA kit, the spinal needle length is 13 centimeter and 26 gauge. Remember this. And TOIS is 16 to 18 gauge. Which technique, needle through needle, or you are using different space techniques, that you should be aware of that. Very few slides. This is a, I also picked up this because standard monitor, ETCO2 monitor, your standard, it's a standard monitor which you're using in every case. So it's a capnometry, basic capnometry instrument for capnometering, for monitoring the ETCO2. One is the mainstream capnometer, on the right side is a side stream capnometer. So you should be aware of what are the mainstream, what are the side stream, the mainstream which is coming in the which is coming in the direct path of the gas source is called as the mainstream, which is away from that is called as the side stream. Then coming to the, if you picked up this instrument, then definitely you will be asked about the indications, confirmation of proper ET tube placement, continuous monitoring of respiratory pattern, effectiveness of CPR, monitoring of pulmonary and cardiac. So you should be aware of that. Now, what is the principle of capnography is infrared spectrography. I'm not going into detail of this, but you should know what is infrared spectrography. Disadvantages. Very common question which is being asked is, the mainstream disadvantages is the it adds dead space and it adds weight to the circuit. And it needs time to heat up to avoid condensation of the heater. Now, about side stream capnometer disadvantages, that the sampling capillary tube can easily become obstructed by water secretions. And water vapor pressure changes within the sampling tube, it can affect the CO2 measurements. So once capnography, you can be asked about the normal capnogram and all the abnormal waveforms, they can be, you know, the Viva can definitely go in that direction. So you should be quite aware of that. Thank you. Dr. Sandeep?